So before I start, there will be some polling during the actual session. I'm using menti.com. So just to test it out, can you connect to the internet either through your smartphone or to your laptop? Go to menti.com, enter the number, and answer the question.
Stay on the page as well.
So just a brief intro. I'm Andrea Mifsud. I have a background of electrical and electronics engineering. I'm currently doing my PhD at Imperial College London in chip design. In this talk, I won't go into too much technical detail, I hope, but I'm happy to discuss this further offline if people want. And I've split the presentation into parts depending on time mainly. So I'll have an idea. I'll basically give you the idea that I have in the first part. And then if we have time, I can delve into more detail in terms of how we use this idea. And the main topic is, as Peter said, it's motors for micromouse, whether it's for driving, or if you want to try suction, you can also use it for suction. So part one, I'd like to know obviously what motors are people using. So let's get into it. So the question you answered before, basically it should have a new question now. You just need to choose which one you've been using. The options are brushless, brushed, stepper, others. Yep, there we go. How much does the motor weigh in grams? Approximately, come on. Okay. Wow, if you have one less than 2 grams, well done. How much does it cost? I'm sure you know this. Maximum rated voltage. By the way, this does not apply to just one motor. It can be all the motors you've ever used if you've built 10 micromice. And finally, size. Stall and peak current. So basically maximum current that your motor can sustain for a short period of time. Largest dimension can be height, diameter, width or length. Okie doke, so we'll continue. So we saw those parameters because basically when we decide what motor we're using, ideally we try to balance out, you know, how much does it weigh? So we ideally try to get one that weighs as minimal as possible. Unless you're a millionaire, you try to reduce your cost. Increase as much power as you can, because also that determines your torque. You try to get a voltage which is not too high or not too low. As we saw, size is very important, so the smallest size you can get, and the smallest rotor inertia as well you can get. So if you want to stop, you stop as soon as you can, and you reduce your momentum. So when it comes to examples, there's the approach of, I'll use the motor that I could find, whatever it is. But then there are also some kind of standards, you could say, that I've seen many people use. There's the Pololulu or the Pimoroniger motors, the Maxon and the Vollhaber 1717. And I'd say they all have advantages and disadvantages, either speed, torque, weight, cost, size. So I was basically in my path to micromouse, building my first micromouse, I thought I'd give this a try and see what's out there. And I came across this motor. It weighs 2 grams, 11.2 by 12.5, 3.7 volts, 26 watts, 7.2 amps, 0.1 ohms, 82% efficiency, 10 pounds, and well, it's 10,000 RPM. So on that note, what do you think? Will it be competitive? I'd like your opinion. Actually, wait, listen. So here you don't know the full story. I'm doing this on purpose to see how it changes when you know the full story of what you need to do to drive this motor. Come on. Here it is. This is it. So what is it? It's a brushless motor, typically used for very, very small drones, literally on the palm of your hand, and typically they have four of these. That's the spec coming from the official manufacturer, and you can see the 3D model of it. And they don't really give you, you know, normal specs of it like you get in a DC motor. They give you the sort of stuff, so basically if you put a propeller on it, what sort of power does it give you? What's the efficiency of gram per watts? How much does it heat up? Because obviously it does. Yeah, that sort of information. But I mean, you can see that it can sustain, you know, 6 amps at 66 degrees Celsius with a propeller on top. But it's not the only one. So, you know, this is just for this specific model. There are several others. So this is the one we're using, the one I just showed you, but you can go lower in terms of size and in terms of power, and you can also go higher. So, you know, if you see power and size and weight as well, you can go up to 70 watts if you'd like. And the dimensions do not change much. So an important point of this is basically the numbers that you see here, 1002 for example, that means the stator with diameter. This diameter, and the 02 is the actual height of the stator. So this means that this distance here is 8 millimeters. And the same thing for this. So this is 12 millimeters, this diameter, and this is 2 millimeters. So you get an idea of size. Any questions up to this point? Nope. So, so I'm going back to basics. Now, how does a motor work? It's typically, basically you have two magnetic fields in the motor. One is typically generated using magnets, and the other one is typically generated using your winding. We pass a current, and that current generates a magnetic field, which interacts with our other magnetic field. So if you open the very basic motor I've shown before, you have these two magnets. They are huge, one on one side and the other one on the other side. You have the coil in the middle. This is the rotor. And in a typical DC motor, you have these brushes that are basically deciding which orientation. They are deciding where to pass the current, whether they are passing it in one particular coil or the other. And that kind of controls the rotation. So as you can see here, these are the brushes, these are the magnets, and these are the coils. So when it's green, it's out, and you want it to be green here to repel, so it can move. And you keep doing this, the brushes do this for you automatically, because they make contact with the commutator that's in there. And so you can keep, you can have more than two poles, we say. You can have more than one coil, I mean. So you can have two, three, four, as many as you want, theoretically. But usually the inefficiency becomes here because you have the brushes, which are basically sparking. They are resistive. You're losing efficiency because of that. And you're also limited in terms of the amount of current you can pass through them. So this is what a brushed motor is, which is what we've seen before. But this is a brushless motor, which basically means, what if you take this architecture and you invert it? You put the coils on the stator, and you put the magnets on the rotor. So the magnets are now on the thing that rotates, and the coils are on the thing that does not rotate. So the brushes are not there anymore. But how will you decide when to commutate? How will you decide when to flip your magnetic field, like we're seeing there, like what the brushes were doing? In this case, you have to do this basically yourself. You have to take care of commutation yourself, which means your control algorithm is much more complex, because now you have to decide when has the rotor moved enough that you have to flip your magnetic field. And so this is what you get. Obviously, here the animation is showing changing automatically, but the idea is that basically when the rotor is in a particular location or position, based on that position, you have to change your magnetic field. And again, the same rules apply. So if you have, let's say, north here, you want to make sure to put north, so north and north repel, and the rotor rotates. So what are the challenges with this type of motors? So you have at least four. There are three input signals now, not two anymore. In a DC brushed motor, you have two signals, so two phases. But in a brushless, you have three. You need to know the position of the rotor to decide when you're going to commutate or when you're going to change the current from one coil to the next. The number of signals to the processor are increasing, and the amount of computer power that you need to control it. Because before, we just had, as I said, two signals. You just apply a voltage, and you control the speed based on that. But now you also have to think about commutation as well, in terms of from one phase to the next. So if we take one challenge at a time, for our typical brushed motor, we have basically two half bridges. But now we have three, because we need to control three different phases. So that's easy enough, and there are chips that can do that. I mean, they have three half bridges. Rotor position feedback, there are many different methods in the literature. You can either use back EMF, which means when a motor is turning, it's basically producing EMF due to its inductance. And you can try to sense that to know when to commutate. Or else there are other methods. So you can basically have field-oriented control, which use the voltages and the currents to estimate the location. Or you can have a separate sensor that does this for you, kind of what we do with the encoders for brushed motors. The number of signals for brushed motor, we typically need two for the H-bridge and one for battery voltage. And for brushless, again, it depends a lot on how you control it. But you need at least three or six for the H-bridge, one for the battery voltage, and at least one for phase voltage, and one for overcurrent limiting, which means you need more peripherals and more power for the processor, and more time, basically, which is challenge four. So now, knowing that, what do you think? Yeah.
I mean, I assume that they rely on the circulation of the air as well.
Yes, to cool down. Yes.
Temporarily, it doesn't work like it can.
Yeah, I mean, the idea is that you can sustain that because you have air from the propeller cooling it down. So that's a question of whether it's good enough for micromouse as well at that particular amperage. But I'm not expecting the load to be as bad as well.
My experience with them as well is they don't work. You don't get a lot of torque out of them at low RPM. So actually getting a robot moving is really difficult.
But from my calculations, the gear that I'm getting is 1:8, which is quite high, which means that the torque I have from the motor needs to be quite low from that perspective, right? So I'm not too concerned about that, because I can also, you know, if I can give it 7 amps, that's quite a lot of power, even if it's just to get it started.
Yeah.
All I can say is that, all I can say is that I've managed to get it started, but I haven't done a micro mouse yet. So.
Look at it. That's in a black box way. You've got the motor, and you need a motor driver and a PWM signal. With a brushless motor, you take the motor, a drone ESC, and a PWM signal. You don't need to provide the computation. That's all done within the speed control.
Yes, if you want to go down the route of using a drone, yes, yes, but I want to go fast. So I want to...
It is possible, most of them don't.
You can use an ESC. I mean, I'm saying this because I want to do DSC myself as well. I don't want to buy myself an ESC.
That's a complicated way to do it, doing it yourself.
But I mean, the only reason you want to do this, use this type of motor, is if you want to go weight. The weight is very low, right, for what it is. So if you want to improve your weight, then why? What's the point of buying your own ESC? Because you're losing that weight anyway.
Okay.
At least that's my reason.
Yeah.
What you get out of this stage that in a typical half-size mouse, competitive half-size mouse, you're talking 10 to 15 grams all up.
So if you've got an encoder on the back of one of those, if you know where it is, you get rid of the motor speed torque problem. I mean, they use them as servo motors with nothing on the end, just torque drive. It's because of the back EMF that you can't.
Yes, the back EMF.
You don't get enough of that at low speeds to get the drive right.
But the ESCs that do with the sensor. Feedback are actually quite large.
It's not simple. You can effectively drive these as low resolution stepper motors, can't you?
Yes, you can.
And that means that you don't worry about commutation, you just give it this phase for long enough and it'll settle there.
And then you give it the next phase.
It's that 0.1 ohm internal resistance that's the interesting challenge.
I mean, the PWM frequencies for this I'm using is at least 200 kilohertz. So the frequencies you need is quite significant, and you also need cycle by cycle current limiting, which I'm using. Because if you don't, then you're basically wasting quite a bit of power. If people want to see them, I have two here, so they'll be available tomorrow as well. Any other questions or comments? I guess time for a break.
Yeah. Sorry. For a dramatic finish. Got it.